Still 29. Oh, it's 30 now. Maybe we can get started early since we have a lot to cover. Okay, yeah, let's get started. We're going to talk about memory controllers. Last time we covered a lot of DRAM. We'll actually cover more of DRAM later on, potentially as guest lectures. But today we're going to talk about how to control DRAM. But before that, since there's a Lab 4 grades, Lab 4 is graded. A lot of you are doing quite well, which makes me happy. I like the curve going that way instead of this way. So if you're around here, you should check with the TAs, definitely. Fewer people did the extra credit on Lab 4, unfortunately. And I think two of them really worked. So they get recognized. Navneet has the second fastest. So if he gets 1% additional credit for the entire course, which is actually pretty significant. And Pete has the fastest, actually. So you get the 2%. And I think one of the extra credits that had good documentation didn't compile, so you should really check with the TA. Okay, announcements. There are no office hours today. If you'd like to meet with me, please send me an email and schedule some time. The reason is there is a seminar that's happening in this room, and I'm hosting that seminar right after this lecture. So I'll be in this room for a long time. But if you would like to attend, actually, it's a very interesting topic. It's a PhD candidate from MIT giving a talk on wireless networks and interference management in wireless networks, actually, which is the topic of today's lecture, except in memory, not wireless networks, obviously. But a lot of the fundamentals are really similar in systems, so it's always good to understand how the things that you learn in this course can potentially be applicable to other areas. So I'll give you a quote from the abstract of this talk, and I would encourage you to attend this talk. You can spend all your day on talks today if you're interested in that. But basically, the statement abstract says, perhaps our biggest expectation from modern wireless networks is faster communication speeds. However, state-of-the-art Wi-Fi networks continue to struggle in crowded environments. I'm sure you all observed that. The core reason is interference. Wi-Fi access points today avoid transmitting at the same time on the same frequency, since they would otherwise interfere with each other. And he talks about the system he developed to reduce that interference or avoid that interference. I see a lot of similarities. Of course, the solutions are different, but the similarities in memory it's really astounding, actually. In memory, cores, whenever they're accessing memory, they interfere with each other because they're a shared medium. It's similar here. There's a shared medium or shared frequency level. And then you need to manage that interference to actually get good performance in memory. Well, same as in wireless networks. The techniques that you use may be very different because of the constraints of the environment and the problem, right? But the problems are really fundamental, the problem of interference. That's why we're going to focus a lot on the problem of interference today. And whenever you're thinking of this, don't think of this as just a computer architecture problem or a memory problem, even though we're going to focus on that. But the problem is actually in all shared resources that you see. Whenever you have a shared resource that's accessed by multiple agents, that includes people also, right? Whenever you have a shared seat, if you want to sit on that shared seat together, well, good luck. Right? You have this fundamental problem of managing interference. And that leads to fairness issues, that leads to performance issues, that leads to quality of service issues. And how you solve them will be important. And if that's not enough talks for you, there's one more talk, which is more related to computer architecture. I would encourage you to attend this talk, definitely. It's on flash memory. And my student, Yixin, will be talking about data retention behavior in flash memory, how to characterize it, how to optimize it, and how to actually recover data using this characterization, even after flash memory is dead, even after you have uncorrectable errors in flash memory. Because you can actually do post-processing in flash memory based on this understanding that you develop of the retention behavior. And even if flash memory gets corrupt, what you can do is you can age it a little bit more and figure out which cells age faster than others, and then predict the values of those cells based on the retention behavior that they exhibit. That's pretty interesting, actually. So we're going to talk a lot about memory controllers. We're going to focus on DRAM memory controllers, but actually controllers are everywhere. Flash memory has a controller also. They're similar to DRAM controllers, but they're specific to flash memory. And they do much more, actually. They do error correction, because flash memory, when you manufacture flash memory, raw flash chips, if you look at these, they just don't work. Actually, more than 50% of the bits are erroneous. So you have to do heavy error correction, heavy signal processing, to actually figure out what the bit really encodes. That's why you have a lot of error correction codes stored in flash memory, and you have these ECC engines that correct the errors and then provide it, supply it to the flash controller. And flash controller is actually a real processor over there that does management of the flash function. So it does not only error correction, but also garbage collection. Because whenever you write to a flash block, if you want to write to a flash block, you first need to erase it. And that erase takes a really long time because of the specifics of the flash memory. We're not going to talk about the underlying technology, but it's good for you to know. So what these erase operations are actually done off the critical path. Basically, you have some of these flash blocks that are not erased, and you do them while you're not accessing flash memory. So that's the garbage collection part. So there are some blocks that are not accessible because you need to erase them first. It doesn't exist in DRAM. That kind of constraint doesn't exist in DRAM. And they do a lot of page remapping also, so that pages, like the erased pages, you should not be able to access them, for example. So it's actually pretty interesting, the SSD controllers. But we're not going to talk about them. But the fundamentals that we will cover today will be applicable to SSD controllers also. Plus, you will need to do a lot more to get an SSD controller to work. So this is where we are in the lecture schedule. We've covered main memory, DRAM, and we're going to talk about memory control and scheduling, and hopefully finish it, although we have a lot of slides. And these are the required readings that you have, so hopefully you're doing them. Okay. So I think I've kind of told you this earlier, but long latency memories have similar characteristics that need to be controlled. I'll use DRAM as an example for the lecture, but there are other types of memories like flash memory, which we just discussed, and other emerging memory technologies, which we will cover. They all need memory controllers. Actually, SRAM needs memory controllers also, right? You have cache controllers in the processor. DRAM is a little bit more complicated, and flash memory is even more complicated as you go farther. Hard disk is even more complicated because it's a very different technology, right? And these other technologies can place other demands on the controller, which we will not necessarily cover. If we had 5 more lectures in this term, we would probably dedicate one of them to SSD controllers. Before I go into controllers, I'll tell you a little bit about DRAM types. Actually, you talk about the fundamentals of the DRAM, but DRAM actually differs. It has different types with different interfaces optimized for different purposes. So you can actually buy different types of DRAM today. Commodity DRAM that you have, not in your laptops actually, your laptops have this type of DRAM more than likely, low power DRAM, LPDDR. But commodity DRAM that you have in your servers, desktops, are actually more optimized for higher performance, whereas mobile DRAM is more optimized for low power. Like what you have here is low power DRAM. There's also DRAM that's optimized for high bandwidth, like graphics DRAM, and low latency. Low latency tends to be very expensive. Embedded DRAM, for example. So some caches use embedded DRAM. And there's also reduced latency DRAM, which is like commodity DRAM, except its subarrays are much smaller. Basically, it has more subarrays, but subarrays are much smaller. Remember the subarrays? By reducing the size of the subarrays, you're reducing the length of the bit lines. As a result, you're reducing the latency. So in RL DRAM, reduced latency DRAM, you have much shorter bit lines. As a result, it's much faster. And you have even newer technologies like 3D stack technologies today, which have even higher bandwidth. Basically, these are technologies that can connect to the processor through silicon vias. So they have lots of, imagine them as pins, but they're really vias connecting. You can put one chip on top of the other chip. As a result, you get 3D stacking. So this kind of DRAM is coming, actually. High bandwidth memory, for example. You will see these more and more happen in GPU space, which is really bandwidth intensive. And WIDIO is similar in some sense. There's also hybrid memory cube, which is a little bit different. They basically stack the controller and the DRAM together, such that you get very high bandwidth between the controller and the DRAM. Okay, so there are a lot of these different technologies, and you can imagine more coming, and more will be coming in the future. The underlying microarchitecture is fundamentally the same. Basically, what we've discussed in the bank microarchitecture, it's essentially the same. the row buffers, they're essentially the same. Where they differ is really the interface and the underlying implementation, which I will not go over. For example, RLDRAM has shorter bit lines, right? Microarchitecture is the same, but how long you have your bit lines is different. Well, eDRAM is actually a little bit different in terms of the DRAM technology itself, but again, fundamentally it's the same. So a flexible memory controller, since our topic is memory controllers, can support various DRAM types. So maybe you would like to have a memory controller that supports many of these different types, right? But this complicates the memory controller. As a result, the memory controllers that we design today do not always support all of the types. It's difficult to do that. And it's difficult to do it for upgrades also, right? What if you design a memory controller, it supports DDR2, and then DDR3 comes up, right? A new standard. And these things differ in terms of latencies, for example. It's difficult to support that. So memory controllers actually get complicated, especially when you have these different technologies. So it's good to think about these going forward. And this just summarizes some of the technologies. This is from a recent paper my students have wrote on flexible DRAM simulation. And there are a lot more proposals that are coming up going forward in the field. So you'll see the DRAM space changing quite a bit, maybe when you take up jobs in industry. So it's good to be aware of that. So what should a DRAM controller do? Well, the first thing is it should ensure correct operation, right? Whenever you design something, it should work correctly. That's why if your design doesn't compile, you don't get extra credit, or you don't get any credit, right? So it should ensure that refresh and timing works correctly. And DRAM actually has a lot of different timing parameters. The reason is you want to optimize for performance. For example, instead of having activate, pre-charge, and read commands, you could actually have a single command that takes the worst case latency, right? You could think of an interface that way. But that way, you always pay the worst case latency, right, with that kind of interface. Memory controllers become more complicated because you have these fine-grained commands that say activate, pre-charge, and read. If the row buffer is open, you just send a read. If the row buffer is, you have a conflict, then you need to pre-charge, activate, and then read. That takes a long time. This makes the memory controller more complicated because now it needs to figure out whether the row buffer is open, closed, dot, 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 which commands it needs to send. But it makes the interface more complicated, but you get higher performance because now you can optimize for the best latency. Hopefully, at least. The second thing is it needs to service DRAM requests while obeying the timing constraints of the DRAM chips. Right? This is basically scheduling. Its job is to do scheduling. And there are many constraints. The resource conflicts, whether the bank, bus, or channel is occupied, whether you're actually satisfying the timing constraint, write-to-read delays, for example. This happens in DRAM. This happens in any memory. But after you do a write, you need to wait for a certain amount of time for the bus to stabilize, for everything to stabilize, the bank to stabilize, the bus to stabilize. So there's a delay before which you can issue a read on the bus. This is also called a turnaround, bus turnaround delay. So it needs to take these into account. If you look at a DRAM data sheet, you actually see more than 50 timing constraints that look like this. And some of them are very obscure. But there are reasons for it. So the job of the controller is to translate requests to these DRAM command sequences, and also to figure out whether a command can be issued or not issued at any given time. The third one is to optimize for performance. Basically, buffer and schedule requests for high performance plus quality of service. So you need to have buffers to buffer the requests. You need to do reordering to get high performance. You need to take into account the status of these different parts of DRAM, row buffer, bank, rank, bus, and we will focus on quality of service a lot in the upcoming part of this lecture. You need to do interference management. Basically, if there are multiple sources that are sending requests, you need to do that management such that you get high overall system performance. If you have 5 cores requesting, or if you have a CPU and GPU that are sharing a memory controller, which exists in many systems today, you don't want to always be servicing only the GPU, right? Then there's no point in having a CPU and GPU sharing the memory controller. So this is a real problem today. And finally, we will get to this very, very little, but it needs to manage the power consumption and thermals in DRAM if this becomes an issue. do energy management, basically. It can turn on or off DRAM chips, DIMMs, and manage different power modes. So we'll try to get to this after we cover a lot of interference management issues. So one key question is where to place the DRAM controller. One thing is you can place it on the CPU chip. This is what most systems look like today. Not all systems. But in the past, this wasn't the case because Moore's law gives you more transistors. What do you place on the chip? Right? Well, memory controller is a very good thing to place on the chip. But in the past, there used to be DRAM controllers on it, in the chipset as their own separate chip. It's called the Northbridge chip that does DRAM control, for example. If you have a separate chip that hosts the DRAM controller, now you have more flexibility, right? You're not tying your DRAM controller to your CPU, which means that if you want to change, if you want to have a new DRAM type in the system, you just change the chip that does the control of the DRAM. You don't need to buy a new CPU with it. Does that make sense? It gives you more flexibility. Of course, the downside is, well, there's another upside, which is less power density in the CPU chip, hopefully, right? You don't have another entity that's doing a lot of processing, which is the memory controller. But if you actually put it on the CPU chip, you actually get reduced latency for main memory access because you don't need to go through another chip to access DRAM. There's no middleman, if you will, to access DRAM. So there's an upside. And in fact, AMD was the first company, at least in the x86 space, that put the memory controller on the chip. And Intel had a lot of discussions to figure out whether they should put the DRAM controller on the chip. And I never understood why that wasn't a no-brainer. Eventually, they put the DRAM controller on the chip, but it was much later than AMD did. So it just makes sense for this purpose. Basically, you're really cutting off a lot of the latency to go to memory because you're not going through another chip. Also, you don't have one more chip in the system, right? That's another benefit of integration in general. And there's another benefit, which is you have higher bandwidth between the cores and the controller. And this becomes even more important, especially when you have multiple cores, multiple applications sharing the memory controller. Now you can communicate more information a lot more easily. Remember, if you're going off chip, you're limited by the pins. And if you want to communicate one more bit of information, you need to add one more pin, unless you can reuse some pin in some way, but that's difficult to do. But if the memory controller is on chip, and if you want to communicate something, let's say the core ID, which core has generated this request, it's easy. You just add some more wires on chip, right? That's cheap. You don't need to add more pins. You can convey the request importance in the processing core, whether a request is a prefetch or not prefetch. In fact, in the old days, this information was not communicated at all to the memory controller. So you had the separate memory controller chip, and you had the CPU chip. CPU would generate prefetch requests, and they would be treated exactly the same way as demand requests coming from the CPU by the memory controller. And the memory controllers, at some point, in Pentium 4, for example, were first in, first out. So you could have actually lots of prefetch requests delaying demand requests, even though prefetch requests may or may not be useful. Whereas if things are on chip, it's a lot easier to communicate this kind of information. Because to distinguish between whether or not you have a prefetch request, you need to add one more pin. Right? Unless you somehow have that pin for some reason. Okay. But this is still a good trade-off. So you know, it's still an important trade-off to examine. There are other reasons, actually, scalability. If you want scalability, you may want to add more chips and more memory controllers. IBM systems, for example, have this what they call the scalable memory interface. They basically have many memory controller chips. And they actually form kind of a hierarchy of memory controllers such that they can scale the size of the memory in the system. Because now you can actually have many, many memory controllers and connect many, many memories without increasing the pin requirements. Whereas if your memory controllers are always with the processor chips, eventually you become limited by the number of pins you have in that chip. Okay, so what does a modern DRAM controller look like? This is kind of a cartoonish picture, but it kind of looks nice. Basically, you have these different agents that are providing request streams, and these could be other things like GPUs today. Always think about what things are today. Actually, in this one, you have a lot of hardware accelerators also. So how do you treat those hardware accelerators becomes an interesting problem. And they're all going through this memory controller, at least for one of the channels over here. And there's an arbiter that basically puts things into the different banks, and you have schedulers that are scheduling from different banks. And eventually, things go out of this interface into the DRAM. This is another way of looking at it. This is an easier way. basically you get requests coming from different agents. They go to different banks, so there's some mapping policy there from the physical address to bank. And then you can have schedule. These are the request buffers. They basically keep the requests. And then scheduler basically picks a request from each bank. And also you can have a second level scheduler that picks which bank to service next. This is one way of building it. This is kind of a partition scheduler. Basically, for each bank, you have a different request buffer, and you have a different scheduler. An alternative is really to have a not partitioned or shared request buffer across all of the banks. And you can imagine this is the same trade-off that we had before, shared versus partitioned structures, right? If one bank has a lot of requests, well, you may stall earlier because you cannot reuse or use the other buffers in other banks. Okay? And the job of the bank scheduler is to pick a request that's ready for each bank. And the job of the DRM bus scheduler is to pick a ready request to schedule onto the DRM bus. Okay? Hopefully this is simple. So in the rest of the discussion, I'll assume that the requests are reads. But one of the important concerns is actually writes. So how do you do write versus read request scheduling? We're not going to talk about that. But this is actually really interesting because to a given DRAM rank, you can only do reads at a time or writes at a time. You cannot run the bus in both directions at the same time. If you're doing a read in one bank, you cannot do a write to the other bank, because that's how you need to do the bus switching, and it just doesn't work out that way. So what the modern memory controllers do is they schedule reads in a batch, and then they switch for a while and do the writes, and then they switch again to the reads, and then they switch to the writes, and then they switch back to the reads again. Does that make sense? Because the bus goes only one way, and the bus is shared between the different banks. And this will become more important, actually, going to other technologies. For example, writes are actually not that expensive in DRAM, in the sense that if you do a write to the row buffer, it's the same latency as reading from the row buffer, although it's getting more expensive because there's a recovery latency penalty in DRAM. But in some other technologies, which we will see, in phase change memory, for example, to be able to do a write to a cell, you need to really melt the material in that cell. And actually, you need to heat it up to crazy temperatures, like 600 degrees Celsius. So to be able to do that, you need to actually apply a current for a long time. And that's, the reads can take like 10 times longer than writes. The writes can take 10 times longer than reads. So this becomes an important problem in such technologies. Same as flash, actually. In flash, writes are much slower than reads also. So the controllers are optimized in different ways to take this into account. But for what's coming next, ignore reads versus writes. I'm going to assume everything is reads. Okay. So what are the DRAM scheduling policies? The simplest one is this, right? This is really not scheduling, actually. You just service whatever comes to you first. Then you're not really doing scheduling. It's really simple. But what we've seen earlier was this, right? First ready, first come, first served. Basically, you prioritize row hit requests. If a request hits in the row buffer, you know the status of the row buffer, and you prioritize that request over others. And everything else being equal, you prioritize the older requests. Make sense? So the goal of this is to maximize the row buffer hit rate, because row buffer accesses are much faster. As a result, you also maximize DRAM throughput. It's a good policy, yeah?
But wait, doesn't this, like, as you said, like, sometimes you should, like, only give GPU, and GPU will have very high row buffer.
Mm-hmm. That's right, yes.
This thing, so won't it crash then?
So we'll get to that, yes. This caused a lot of interference. That's right. But the first one is not fair either. But this makes it perhaps even worse. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this basically unfairly prioritizes applications that keep hitting in the row buffer, right? Actually, GPUs are a really good example for that, because they're usually the programs that are written on GPUs are optimized for high locality, high bandwidth from the DRAM. As a result, they keep hitting in the row buffer with long streaks. So I didn't say that this is the best policy. But this is actually implemented in most modern memory controllers, although they're incorporating what we will discuss into them as time goes by. In the old times, memory controllers were FCFS, actually. Pentium 4 had actually chipsets that had FCFS, and even though the processor was heavily optimized, memory was so dumb and slow, right? You do all of these out-of-order scheduling in the processor to optimize small latencies, and in the end, you're bottlenecked by memory. you're really waiting for 10 prefetch requests to be serviced before a single demand, 10 useless prefetch requests to be serviced before a single demand is serviced. So that's why it's really important to focus on this side of the system. Okay, so scheduling is actually done at the command level, and you know this. It's not at the request level, in a sense, because you have these column commands that are read and write. Those are prioritized over row commands in this scheduling policy, activate and precharge, right? Within each group, older commands are prioritized over younger ones. That's actually how the scheduling policy works. You can actually have another schedule that prioritizes at the request level also. And you can think about how to do these things. So what is the DRAM scheduling policy? If you think about it, it's really a prioritization order in the end, right? You're forming a priority order at the DRAM controller. And this can be based on many, many things. I've just given you two things, right? The age of the request and the row buffer hit status. But there could be other things. Request type. Is the prefetch, read, or write? And actually, read and write, I've just discussed that. But prefetch, how do you actually prioritize prefetches over demands? It's actually not clear, because there are useful prefetches. And if the prefetch is useful, maybe you do want to treat it the same priority as a demand request, right? Because, and this becomes even more complicated if you think about it. If you have a potentially useful prefetch that hits in the row buffer versus a demand request that misses in the row buffer, and they go to the same bank. Which one do you prioritize? Well, it may make sense to service the prefetch quickly, and if it's useful, you get the data quickly, and you don't need to do a row conflict, right? You don't need to close the row, access the demand, service the demand, and then go back to the prefetch, close the row again. Right? Requester type, whether it's a load miss or a store miss. It's actually different from read and write, right? Because if you have a load miss or a store miss, they can both generate cache misses, and in the end, in DRAM, they're both read misses, right? Because you're reading DRAM, you're not writing to DRAM. Because when you do the store, you do it in the cache, and the writes that the DRAM sees are really writebacks coming out of the cache. Remember, we have lots of caching, and in the end, the writes are not really coming from the stores directly. They're really coming from dirty cache blocks that are being written back into the DRAM. Request criticality. How important is this request? And there could be many measures of this, right? Oldest miss in the core. Is this the most important miss? Well, maybe. Yeah. Oh, prefetch. We'll cover that. But basically, a prefetch is a request. It's not from a load, but it's from the processor predicts what it's going to access next.
Pipeline prefetch.
Say it again.
Well,
it could be instruction, it could be data, right? The processor basically predicts what is going to access next and speculatively sends a request, even though there's no load associated with it. Okay? We'll cover prefetching in more detail. How many instructions in the core are dependent on it? Will it stall the processor? So these are good questions to ask. One thing that we will focus a lot on is the interference caused to the other cores, because this is really fundamental, as we've discussed earlier. But you can imagine these other things being taken into account also. And there's actually a lot of work. So, if you look at DRAM controllers, they do take into account some of these, but I'm not going to cover those in detail. You can imagine different ways of doing that. They usually, today's DRAM controllers usually do this in a very relatively ad hoc fashion. So, for example, some DRAM controllers always prioritize demand requests over prefetch requests. It turns out that's really not a good thing. Because if your prefetches are really useful, if you prioritize a demand request over a prefetch request, you may actually lose DRAM throughput. Okay, and you can imagine other things also, actually. Let me talk about row buffer management policies before I go into scheduling. Well, this is actually related to scheduling also, but there are also different ways of managing the row buffer. I'll talk about three ways. One is the open row. Basically, what do you do to the row buffer after an access? Open row means after you access a location in DRAM, after you do a read or write, you keep the row open. You don't do a precharge right away. Now, the upside of this is if the next access goes to the same row, you get a row hit. So you save the activate latency. The downside is if the next access goes to a different row, now because you kept the row buffer open, you need to do a precharge first. If you had done the precharge as quickly as possible, you would have hidden that latency. Right? As a result, you get wasted energy. So it really depends, the usefulness of this policy, the performance of this policy depends on what happens to the next access, right? If you're always doing random accesses to DRAM, maybe you don't want to do open row policy, right? Because you're never hitting in the row buffer to begin with, because your access pattern is not that way. If you're always streaming through DRAM, probably you want to keep the row buffer as long open as long as possible. Closed row policy, on the other hand, it closed the row after an access. The bad way of implementing this is basically, whenever you do an access, you close the row right away, without looking at what's buffered in the memory controller. The smarter way of doing this is, you close the row only if there are no other requests to the same row already pending in the request buffer of the memory controller. So a lot of the memory controllers, actually, when they do closed row policies, they do it smartly. They don't do it dumbly. Because if there's already a request that's requesting that row buffer, you're going to open the row buffer again. Right? It makes no sense to close it right away. So again, the upsides and downsides are exactly opposite here. If the next access needs a different row, closed row is good because you avoid a row conflict by pre-charging the bank quickly. If the next access needs the same row, now you have an extra activate latency, right? Because you don't want to close it right away. So now you guessed, right? Sometimes open row is better, sometimes closed row is better. How do you get the best of both worlds? I didn't hear the magic word. Predict, right? And actually, some memory controllers do this today. They're adaptive policies that try to predict whether or not the next access to the bank will actually go to the same row. And this is actually not a hard predictor to design. If you're, for example, streaming through the memory, you can guess that, right? If your accesses are going to cache block A, A plus 1, A plus 2, A plus 3, that all happen to be in the same row buffer, well, maybe you predict that the next access is going to the same row buffer, right? Okay? And this way, you can actually adapt whether you use the open row or closed row. This way, you can easily figure out also, actually, one other way of doing this is just keeping track of your row buffer hit rate. If your row buffer hit rate is close to 10%, maybe you do the closed row policy. If your row buffer hit rate is over, I don't know, 80%, some threshold, maybe you do the open row policy. That's not the best policy, but this is to give an idea of how you can design an adaptive policy. Okay, I think I'll skip this because we've already kind of covered this. So depending on the policy and depending on what first access and next access you have, these are the different commands that are needed for the next access. I'll go over one of these. For example, if you have a memory controller that's used a closed row policy, I guess it is interesting, sure. And the first access to row zero, and the next access also goes into row zero. What's happening here? Yeah. And the access is not in the request buffer. You don't know whether the next access actually goes to row zero at that point in time. So what you do after the first row access is you actually pre-charge the array. And then when you see this access, the next access, you need to activate row zero again. This basically shows the downside of a closed row policy, right? Because you do actually need to activate row zero and then do a read and then a pre-charge after that. Okay? So you can actually go through this table yourself, fill it out, if you will. An open row policy, if the first access to row zero, you keep the row open after that. If the next access goes to row zero, you get a row hit, and you just need to do a read. So that shows the upside of the open row policy or the closed row policy here. Okay. Any questions? Yes?
Do buffered DRAMs actually buffer the entire row, and you can actually close the row, keep a buffer, basically a copy of the entire row, and then send it? Is that what buffered DRAMs?
No, buffer DRAM is actually different. So all of the DRAMs have this row buffer today internally. Buffer DRAM it's really a buffer DIM or registered DIM. So they have actually a small buffer in the DIM itself. We're not going to cover that, but you don't need to worry about that also. Okay? But I think what you're saying is you can perhaps add another row buffer somewhere else, right, and buffer the row internally in the DRAM. And if you have actually multiple row buffers, now you can manage that as an associative cache, yeah. Right? So that actually becomes interesting. And people have proposed that. The downside of that is expensive. It makes the DRAM more expensive because you need more buffers. The reason you have this row buffer is it's really the sense amplifiers. You have to have it, right? Because they really amplify amplify the data. You have to have it for being able to be able to read the data. If you add one more buffer, it's just extra cost because you don't really need to have it. But it's really SRAM that you're implementing in DRAM chip, and that adds a lot of cost. Actually, row buffers are pretty expensive parts of the chip. Any other questions? Okay. So we'll talk about memory interference for the rest of this lecture, and I have a lot of slides because it's an important topic. But we'll go through. I covered this because it's definitely an important topic that's actually being implemented in controllers today. It's going to be more important in the future. And this will hopefully give you an idea of a problem that's modern in systems today and how we can take different approaches to solve that problem. And maybe you can develop some other approaches going forward. But this is the modern DRAM controller that we've seen today. And you remember the bank operation, right? I'm going to go through this really quickly. Basically, if the access is to an open row, it's pretty quick, right? You get a row hit. That's what this is, basically. If the access goes to a closed row, which is the next one over here, or conflict row, if you have a different row open in the row buffer than the one you're trying to access, you get a row buffer conflict. As a result, you need to activate, you need to pre-charge and then activate and then read. And your homework 5 has a nice question that you need to go through that will hopefully reinforce all of these concepts really well. So in a single core system, because the row conflict memory access takes significantly longer than the row hit access, the controllers take advantage of this fact, right? Basically, there's a reason for this policy that we've discussed, row hit first policy. There are two goals, actually. One is because by prioritizing row hits, you maximize row buffer hit rate. As a result, you maximize the DRAM throughput. By prioritizing older requests, you hopefully ensure forward progress, right? Oldest first has one good characteristics, which is you always ensure forward progress. Because at some point, a request will become oldest because you're not reordering other requests before it. And as a result, forward progress is guaranteed, or starvation freedom is guaranteed. This is different from fairness, by the way, because an application may be generating lots of requests. Another application may be generating one request. And because this application is generating lots of requests and you have a buffer that can buffer them, this other application is generating one request, it gets delayed behind all of these requests. You're still doing all this first policy because you'll service all of these requests from application, the first application, but you're not fair to this application that's generating only one request. Right? Maybe if you service that application request, you'll just continue making progress, right? So oldest first is a starvation-free policy, but it's not a fair policy. So the key question is this a good policy in a multi-core system? And you know the answer from lecture 1, right? It's definitely not a good policy. And we'll see how to fix that problem in this lecture. Basically, if you have many cores on a chip, there are many reasons for this. We can talk about that later. But what you really want is n times the system performance with n times the cores, hopefully. That's linear scaling, right? Well, life is not that beautiful, unfortunately. You almost never get linear scaling. So what you get today is something like looks like this. This is from the first lecture, if you remember, right? MATLAB and GCC. This is one of my favorite slides in life, I guess, so far. Basically, if you run these two programs on a dual core system, at least in 2006, this is what you get. And I think it's much better today, but it's still not fair enough. But basically, one program slows down very little compared to when it's run alone on the same system without the other core doing any accesses, whereas the other program slows down a lot compared to when it's run alone on the same system. And this doesn't change even if you give low priority to this program and high priority to this program, because both of the programs get scheduled on the two cores, and operating system scheduler has no awareness of what's going on in the memory controller. So it doesn't deschedule a program to ensure that it makes forward progress, because it's not even aware of the interference that's happening in the microarchitectural resources, right? The operating system scheduler, from the operating system's perspective, once it schedules a program onto a core, it's making progress. Right? It doesn't think about, it doesn't even know whether it's actually making progress. Right? You give a time slice for 10 milliseconds, let's say, for a particular program, it's on the core. It may make zero progress, but from the operating system's perspective, it's making progress. That's another thing that, going forward, is going to change in systems. Okay, so this is unexpected, and we've kind of seen the reason for this, right? At least in this particular case, the reason was uncontrolled interference in the memory controller, because the memory controller was basically a row hit first. It used a row hit first scheduler. Basically, this is what the system looks like, and I'm going to call these stream and random, because I'm going to actually build some programs that have this kind of behavior. Assume that you have two programs, streaming programs and random access, a streaming program and a random access program. Streaming program keeps accessing the row buffer, the same row. A random access program basically accesses memory randomly, so it has a low row buffer hit rate. If you run these two together, what the memory controller that's the memory controller that prioritizes row hits would do this basically. It would keep prioritizing the streaming program. Make sense? Because all of its requests, well, most of its requests are actually row buffer hits. And you can actually write these programs easily. Some of you have read this paper because it was one of the required readings, one of the potential readings you could choose from. You could actually write a streaming program really easily. One example looks like this, right? Basically, you have two large arrays, and you're copying one array to another array. And assuming that you have row interleaving in the system, what happens is the consecutive elements in this array, consecutive cache blocks in an array, get mapped to consecutive locations in the row buffer. So you get row buffer hits in this case. And this program, we ensure that you actually get cache misses in all accesses by adjusting the index this way. So this is very sequential. As a result, it gets very high row buffer locality, and the measurements show that 96% hit rate in the row. It's very memory intensive because you get misses in all accesses. You can actually write the dual of this program, basically exactly the same program, except it's random access. Right? Instead of using an index that's kind of streaming, accessing consecutive locations in memory, you do the copying by accessing random locations in the array. And this is kind of the pseudocode for this. It's not actually the real code, because if you actually insert a random function here, that becomes really slow. What you really need to do a good comparison is actually pre-compute the indices over here and then do that copying. Okay? So this has random memory access, very low row buffer locality because you're copying random locations. And it's similarly memory intensive because of this randomness, you get cache misses, because the cache is not effective when you have random accesses, right? Okay. So what does the memory hog do if you actually have these two programs? This will be the memory hog, actually, if these actually happen to map to the same bank. So what does this program do? If you look at it, assume that the row buffer has row 0 open to begin with, and the streaming program keeps accessing row 0, and the random access program keeps accessing different rows, what happens is the memory controller prioritizes the streaming program because it keeps sitting in the row buffer, right? And it keeps doing that over and over and over and over until the streaming program stops requesting that row, right? It may take a while. I guess it is taking a while. So with a row size of 8 kilobytes, which is pretty common today, actually, and with a cache block size of 64 bytes, you get 128 requests of the streaming program service before a single request of random access program. Now, some memory controllers actually today, they have ad hoc measures for fairness. They do this kind of reordering. So what's happening here is you're really doing reordering of requests. You're not doing oldest first anymore. You're doing reordering based on the row buffer status. What they do is they say if a request has waited for, let's say, longer than 5,000 cycles, stop doing all reordering and service that request. It's kind of a hammer, right? Which is really not, it's good for, again, starvation freedom. It fixes the starvation problem, but it's not really fair again. Fairness is actually a really difficult thing to achieve in systems in general, because the definitions of fairness may vary also, right? Okay, so what is the effect of this actually? These are measurements from the paper. This is actually one of the earlier multi-core systems, Intel Pentium D. You guys probably never worked with Intel Pentium D. You did? Maybe. Yeah, this is actually one of the earliest systems. And what you get is if you run stream and random, the programs that I showed you, stream slows down by 18% and random slows down by 2.82x, almost three times when they're run together on the same system compared to when they're run alone on the same system. Okay? And this is actually repeatable on many different kinds of systems. And if you're interested, you can repeat it in today's systems and see if the memory controllers are still fair or not. I'm actually curious. I haven't done this experiment in a long time. And actually, stream is kind of a performance hog because it kind of denies service to everyone that it runs with. Virtual PC was Microsoft Virtual Machine. And this becomes an even bigger problem, actually, as you increase the number of cores. So this is actually, again, results from a four-core system. Libquantum looks like stream. Libquantum is actually, these are benchmarks from the SPEC 2006 benchmark suite. These used to be the workloads that you measure the performance of processors with. SPEC is Standard Performance Evaluation Corporation. they basically use to release, well, they still release benchmarks to measure performance of systems. Spec marks, as they're called, are actually measuring performance of workloads that are CPU intensive. They're not really I/O intensive. There's also other workloads that are like web workloads or more I/O intensive workloads, Java workloads that they develop. But these are some of the single-threaded workloads, and this is a quantum computing simulator that has characteristics that are really, really similar to stream. You get a lot of memory misses, a lot of read misses, and you're streaming through memory. As a result, it denies service to other applications that are running together with each other. OmnetPP is a network simulator. It has less intensity in terms of memory because it actually fits in the cache. But when it has requests, it gets delayed behind the request of libquantum. In this case. As a result, you get almost an 8x slowdown. And H.264, you probably are familiar with it, right? That's a video encoder decoder. And it probably has real-time requirements based on the quality of service the user receives. So it gets slowed down by 5x. So if you happen to run these programs, you get basically unfair slowdowns, right? And you might ask, when are you running these programs? Then, well, in data centers, for example, right? If you do cloud computing, you can actually get programs from very different users, and they could be running anything, right? Actually, when we were talking about this like 10 years ago or so, people used to ask, when are you ever going to run these programs together? Well, dream and people will do it. And people are doing it. And you're doing it over here also, actually. You may not realize it, right? There are other programs that are running when you're running your own program that you really care about. And if you get responsiveness issues, this could be one of the reasons. Okay, so you get unfair slowdown of different threads. You get low system performance also because of this interference. Actually, this is not only a fairness problem, it's also a performance problem. Why? Because these programs may actually have a lot of potential for quick progress. They may not be very memory intensive, whereas this one is really memory intensive. So this has, let's say, one request that's getting delayed behind 128 requests of libquantum. You're prioritizing libquantum over this program that's not memory intensive. As a result, its core is making very slow progress. Whereas if you prioritized, let's say, OmnetPP, one request, it would actually go back to its core and do a lot of computation, and it would keep its core busy. As a result, you would get much better system utilization. So you can improve performance by changing the priority of these workloads. And you get vulnerable to denial of service, actually. Because libquantum is really hogging performance, it's really denying service to everyone. So if someone actually writes such a program and submits it to your data center, or if someone writes an app and submits it and you download it for some reason, you could actually write memory performance hogs, right? And that could lead to a lot of unintended consequences. So you get priority inversion. As I said, you cannot prevent this actually in the system. You cannot actually enforce these priorities. Even though a user assigns high priority, let's say to H.264ref, that priority doesn't get conveyed to the memory controller. So as a result, you cannot enforce the priorities. You cannot enforce the service level agreements in a cloud computing setting. And this actually changes depending on what you run. So the slowdown you get for an application is now becomes very, very dependent on what you're running that application with. So this is another problem, basically, your performance predictability problem, right? You may optimize your code, and you get one execution time when you run it with some applications, and a totally different execution time when you run it with other applications, right? So this basically breaks down a lot of the assumptions on performance optimizations that you do. In a sense, they're useless, right? Because they really depend on what other thing that's running together with you. So you don't get any performance isolation, and that's usually a good property, especially if you care about performance. So as a result, what you get is, because of this kind of interference, you have an uncontrollable, unpredictable system. You cannot control it, you cannot enforce priorities, and you cannot predict it because you don't have any performance isolation, and they're all caused by these three different problems. So how do you fix the problem? And this actually, I'm going to use memory controllers as an example, since we're going to talk about memory controllers, but this happens in caches also, right? If your cache has an LRU policy, you're again vulnerable to all of these issues because it's really not aware of the threads, right? A thread may be really LRU friendly, and another thread may be not very LRU friendly, a random access thread, for example, right? And the cache can actually prioritize or deprioritize either one, even with an LRU policy, right? If a thread has a huge working set, it's streaming through memory, it's not reusing everything, then it's going to thrash other workloads in the cache. And other workloads, even though they may have small working sets and they could benefit from the cache, because they don't have, because the cache is thrashing, because the cache management policy is causing thrashing, they will not get any good performance. And the solution is, again, isolation, right? Somehow managing this interference. If you figure out which workload is benefiting from the cache and which workload is not, maybe you allocate more cache to the workload that's benefiting from the cache. Okay, so how do you solve this problem in the memory controllers? Well, let me actually recap the problem. Basically, I think the solution is actually harder in the memory controllers because memory controllers are much more complicated than the cache. Because you have pins, controllers, and memory banks that are shared. And the pin bandwidth is not increasing as fast as the number of cores, and bandwidth per core is as a result reducing. So this will become a bigger problem going forward. And different threads executing on different cores interfere with each other, and they delay each other by causing resource contention in any parts of the system. It could be at the bus, it could be at the bank, it could be at the row buffer. As a result, you get reduced DRAM throughput. And I'll show you another problem in a little bit. Threads can also destroy each other's DRAM bank parallelism. Remember, a thread may have very good parallelism in DRAM, and as a result, its requests can be serviced in parallel. Whereas if you have interference, that nice parallelism can get destroyed. It's actually true for all resources, as we've seen with the MLP-aware cache replacement, if you remember. So we'll get to that. So what are the effects of inter-thread interference in DRAM? It's clear that you get queuing or contention delays, right? You get all these conflicts that delay you for a while, right? Actually, there are a lot of real-life examples of this also. If you have a shared resource, one of my favorite examples is when you're walking on the Forbes Bridge that goes over Neville. The bandwidth is really low over there, right? At least the walking bandwidth. I don't know about the car bandwidth. And if you have someone walking slowly in front of you, and I tend to walk really fast, you're basically contending for that resource, and you cannot pass them, right? Done. How do you solve this problem? Well, increase the bandwidth. That's one solution to the problem, right? You have a much wider sidewalk that actually relieves the interference problem. Or assign different lanes to people that require different speed. That's actually how you solve a lot of the quality of service problems also, right? You dedicate lanes, right? But then that reduces overall throughput perhaps, right? You gotta be careful about that. Okay, so these queuing and contention delays happen whenever you have resource conflicts. You have also additional delays in DRAM due to specific DRAM protocol constraints. These are called protocol overheads. For example, row conflicts, right? Row conflicts lead to additional delays in DRAM. In fact, if you have two threads that are accessing DRAM, they could both get worse performance than when they're run alone in the system. In the end, you'll have actually much worse performance because each thread, when they're run alone, can be hitting in the row buffer. But when they're run together, they may all be getting row conflicts now, right? Which actually increases the latencies significantly. And also there's other protocol overheads like read-to-write delays. As I said, you cannot switch the bus. You can do only reads or only writes on the bus at a given time. You have to switch it to switch from read-to-writes. And while you're switching, you cannot send any requests on the bus. As a result, you have dead cycles. So if you keep switching between reads and writes, you actually reduce your DRAM throughput significantly. And finally, I will talk about this in a little bit. Basically, a thread's concurrent requests can become serial. It can become serviced serially instead of in parallel. And we'll see this example in a little bit. So basically what the problem is really, you have quality of service unaware memory controls. Existing controllers are unaware. Actually, that's changing right now. Maybe I should change this existing a little bit because there are actually controllers. Some of the ideas that I will talk about, parallelism or batch scheduling, for example, are implemented in the controllers that you have in your cell phones. At least some particular cell phones. I don't know about this one, because Apple tends to be very, very secretive about what they do. But if you have a Samsung cell phone, some of the ideas that we will discuss will be in there. So maybe this existing is too strong over here. Let's say many existing. They're unaware of this inter-thread interference. They simply aim to maximize DRAM throughput. As a result, they're thread unaware and thread unfair, right? If your goal is just to maximize DRAM throughput, you always prioritize a thread that gets the best throughput from the DRAM, right? Bad idea, if that's not your goal. So FRF CFS policy, we've already discussed this, so I'm going to skip this. But basically, it unfairly prioritizes threads with high robot for locality as a result, and also highly memory intensive. Because all this first policy actually is unfair because it unfairly favors threads that are more memory intensive over other threads. So how do you solve this problem? So we'll talk about a lot of potential solutions. Basically, you need to be more fair in memory scheduling. And fairness is one thing, but you also maybe want to provide performance guarantees. So I call this the quality of service aware memory request scheduling. You need to be aware of the quality of service that you're giving to these different cores. The job of the memory controller is to resolve memory contention by scheduling requests. And a quality of service aware memory scheduler schedules requests to provide not only high system performance, but also high fairness to applications and configurable to system software. And these are actually relatively tied together. How do you actually provide system performance and fairness together? Now you're really optimizing for two different metrics. By the way, first ready, first come, first serve is not good for system performance either, right? I think we made that clear. You're really optimizing for DRAM throughput over there. That's very different from system performance in the end. If you're running a single application that's bottlenecked by DRAM throughput, that's the same. You're really optimizing for system performance. GPUs, for example, if you're running a single application and your bottleneck is DRAM throughput, then optimizing for DRAM throughput may be a good idea. But if you're running multiple applications on GPUs, again, even that's not a good idea. And GPUs are going that way. There's no question. It's very clear that GPUs will run multiple applications going into the future. They actually already have support, some support for that. But it's going to have more support. They're going to look more like multi-cores, where you have different applications that can compete for resources. So even in GPUs, you don't want to maximize just DRAM throughput. So we'd like to be able to do all of these. And clearly, memory control needs to be aware of threads to be able to do that. So I'll give you, what I'll do in the next part of this lecture is go through a lot of, at least three different policies to talk about how you actually can fix the problem. Hopefully, this will give you some ideas on potential solutions. So when we first started thinking about this, how do you actually provide fairness? It was actually a real fairness problem, right? You have this kind of fairness, unfairness problem. One application slows down very little, another application slows down a lot. How do you fix the problem? Well, would it be nice if all applications slow down exactly by the same amount? That's basically fair memory scheduling, right? And how do you do that? I'm not going to go over this in a lot of detail, but I'll give you the basic ideas. Assuming that all applications are equal priority, maybe that's not a bad idea, right? You minimize the variation of slowdown across different applications. And if applications have different priorities, maybe you can actually prioritize them. So if you read the paper, there is actually provisions that are provided such that the system software can communicate the priority of an application, and the memory controller actually prioritizes the application that has higher priority. But let's assume that the applications have equal priority right now. And that's actually true in some cases. Basically, threads sharing main memory should experience similar slowdowns compared to when they're run alone. That's fair scheduling. That's one definition of fairness in this case. Again, remember that there may be many different definitions of fairness. One other definition of fairness could be each thread gets equal amount of bandwidth. Now you can imagine what's good about this, what's bad about this. Well, bandwidth is not necessarily performance, right? That's why, actually, we went into slowdown, because slowdown is what's actually seen by the user in the end. Whereas bandwidth, user doesn't care about how much bandwidth a program gets as long as it sees some amount of performance, right? Some execution time. So this also improves overall system performance by hopefully ensuring that cores make proportional progress. If you think about it, you're really trying to enable proportional progress of different cores. And that's actually good for scheduling policies and the operating system also, right? Implicitly, the operating system kind of is assuming whenever you schedule an application to a core, it's making progress. And implicitly, the progress for equal priority threads is equal across different cores. So this plays nicely with the operating system schedule policies. So the idea was to have the memory controller estimate each thread's slowdown due to interference dynamically while it's running these threads and schedule requests in a way to balance those slowdowns. That's the high-level idea. Now, how do you implement this? Well, basically, I'll go through this very quickly, basically. What we're trying to do is a DRAM system is fair if it equalizes slowdown of equal priority threads relative to each thread is run alone on the same system. So you can actually, the memory controller can compute the DRAM-related stall time of a thread, the time a thread spends waiting for DRAM memory. All it needs to do, well, it needs to know which threads actually have generated those requests. So it needs to have a thread ID. And it can compute stall time shared. Basically, this is the stall time of the thread when the thread runs alone with other, runs together with other threads. And it needs to figure out somehow this, and I'm not going to tell you exactly how it does this, but basically, it needs to figure out what would the thread's DRAM-related stall time be if the thread ran alone. It needs to do this while the thread is running together with other things. And then it would compute a value for each thread that looks like this, stall time shared divided by stall time alone. This is the relative increase in stall time due to interference from other threads. Okay? This should be 1 if there is no other thread that's running together with this thread, right? And the stall time fair memory scheduler aims to equalize this memory slowdown value for interfering threads without sacrificing performance. Okay? And we've already discussed this, basically. So what is the scheduling algorithm? Basically, for each thread, the DRAM controller tracks this shared stall time that you get running together with others, and estimates this alone stall time. And the key difficulty is really how to estimate this alone stall time, right? Because you're really running together with other threads. How do you actually figure out what your alone stall time would be? And in this case, basically, I'll give you a basic idea. For example, if the memory controller schedules a request from thread A, while thread B can also be scheduled on the bus or on the bank, basically you're causing delay to thread B's request. So you can actually keep track of how much delay you caused to another thread because you picked some other thread over this thread. And you can accumulate all of these delays and then estimate how much stall time you're causing to some other thread because you're prioritizing this thread versus that other thread. Yes?
Wouldn't you also have to keep track of how much faster you also got? Because it's likely that you could also get cache hits because of blocks that another thread accessed.
Cache hits meaning row buffer
hits?
Exactly, yes. So in this case, we kind of ignore that. We assume that that doesn't happen. But yes, if you really want to be very accurate about the stall time or about the slowdown, you do need to keep track of that. If threads are actually sharing a row buffer. And this happens when threads actually share data. But in the applications that we've examined, that did not happen. Okay? But you're right. You could actually improve performance because of this. That doesn't happen very often, though, even when threads are sharing a lot of data. Okay. So each cycle, the DRAM controller computes a slowdown for each thread, which is stall time shared divided by stall time alone. For threads with legal requests, of course. If a thread cannot send any requests, then you cannot do that. And then it computes an unfairness value for the entire system. Unfairness is basically the maximum slowdown of any thread in the system divided by the minimum slowdown of any thread in the system. Now, our goal is to actually make this value closer to 1, right? That's basically the variation of the slowdowns between the maximum, the thread that's been slowed down the most, the thread versus the thread that's been slowed down the least. And if unfairness is less than some tolerable threshold, the memory controller uses the DRAM throughput-oriented scheduling policy, which is row hit first, because unfairness is not a problem in that system. If the unfairness is greater than some tolerable threshold, and this could be conveyed by the operating system, it uses a fairness-oriented scheduling policy. In this case, basically, the memory controller picks a request from the thread that has the maximum slowdown and schedules that. That's the prioritization policy. And over the second is basically, if this is all else being equal after that, you do first ready, first come, first serve. Okay? It's pretty simple, basically. You switch to a fairness-oriented scheduling policy if fairness is a problem. But, of course, you need to keep track of all of these to figure out whether there's a fairness problem. And actually, how to do this easily is a key question right now. And I'm not going to talk about this, but there's actually much simpler ways of estimating how to do this. And maybe we'll have a guest lecture related to that. So how does this work, actually? I'll give you a pictorial way of looking at this. Basically, you keep track of each thread's slowdown, and you keep track of the unfairness, which is basically max slowdown divided by min slowdown. In this case, we have only 2 threads. And remember, T0 was the streaming thread, T1 was the random access thread. And let's assume that the maximum tolerable unfairness is 1.05. So if these maximum and minimum slowdown deviate from each other by 1.05x, you actually switch to a fairness oriented policy. So let's take a look. This streaming thread, T0, accesses row 0, and then T1 has a request now. The memory scheduler is still using the throughput oriented scheduling policy, first ready, first come, first serve. So it prioritizes the thread that hits in the row buffer, And this caused additional delay to T1, right? Because T1, if T1 were running alone, its request would have been scheduled. Now it's delayed behind this request. So you compute how much additional delay it incurs, and then you add it up. As a result, your unfairness increases. But unfairness is still okay. It's below that alpha. As a result, the memory controller keeps using the throughput-oriented scheduling policy, so it will still prioritize T0, which sits in the row buffer, and this causes some more delay. Now unfairness becomes intolerable, so the memory controller now switches to the fairness-oriented scheduling policy. Instead of picking the row hit request, it picks the request from the red thread, which has been treated unfairly according to its calculations. And after doing this, basically the row buffer changes, and you cause slowdown to thread 0, because thread 0 is being interfered with now. If it were running alone, it wouldn't have seen this row buffer change, right? But now unfairness becomes in check, right? It's below the value, so the memory controller switches back to the throughput-oriented scheduling policy and picks the oldest request right now, because none of them are hits in the row buffer, right? And then it does the scheduling. So over time, basically, what happens is the memory controller switches back and forth between the fairness-oriented and throughput-oriented scheduling policies to keep unfairness in check within that bound that's provided probably by the operating system. In fact, actually, by changing this alpha value, you can trade off between fairness and throughput in the system. Okay, I'll cover this and then we'll take a break. So what are the upsides of this? The upsides are actually what kind of works, right? It gives you a much better bound on fairness than what your row hit first policy would give. And you could actually, by the way, you could actually apply these policies to other systems also. It's not just DRAM. You could actually think about doing something similar in caches, right? You could estimate how much slowdown you're causing to other applications in the cache because you're sharing the cache. You need to have different mechanisms to estimate that. And then you can prioritize the applications that have been slowed down the most in the cache. So the upside is basically it gives you at least an initial algorithm for fair multi-core memory scheduling. It may not be the best algorithm. Because of the downsides we will see. It provides a mechanism to estimate a memory slowdown of a thread. And actually, this could have a lot of uses. If you do it accurately, then what you're doing is really, you're saying, this is the performance that I'm getting. And now the user can specify, oh, I don't want the thread slowed down by more than 2x. 2x is okay. That's my tolerable limit. But if you're slowing it down by more than 2x, then don't do it, right? Now you can actually provide performance guarantees if you can do this accurately. So it's good at providing fairness. And being fair can improve performance. Actually, if you look at the results, you actually get much better performance with this policy compared to row hit first policy. Because if you have a row hit first policy, one core may be making progress and another core is not utilized. Whereas if you're fair, you're making proportional progress in all of the cores in the system. So the downside, it doesn't handle all types of interference. Well, this will become clear when we talk about bank level parallelism in a little bit. It's actually complex to implement. How do you actually figure out the slowdowns? Well, maybe you can think about potential ways, but the way I've described it's actually very complex to implement. So it's not a good idea, actually, mainly because of this reason. Okay, and slowdown estimations can be incorrect, depending on how you do this. If they're incorrect, then you cannot do this predictable performance, right? Any questions? This is just to motivate you to give you an idea of how you can actually solve this problem. This could be a useful solution, assuming you solve these issues. And hopefully we'll have a guest lecture that actually solves a lot of these issues. So whenever you're proposing a new algorithm, you may not be able to solve all of these issues. Maybe we were too naive when we first proposed this. Okay, so let's take a break for 4 minutes, and then we'll talk about a few other schedulers that are easier to implement and some of the ideas are actually adopted in industry. Yeah. We have a lot to cover. So we'll talk about another problem with interference. And this is actually something that you're already familiar with, right? You know that processors today tolerate the latency of DRAM requests or any kind of long latency requests by generating multiple outstanding requests. This is the notion of memory level parallelism. And there are many ways of doing that. We'll talk about runtime execution a little bit in a few lectures, but out-of-order execution, non-blocking caches, prefetching also. So this is effective. This kind of tolerance is effective, if you think about it, only if the DRAM controller actually services the multiple requests in the different banks in parallel, right, or in different channels in parallel. If the DRAM controller actually serializes these requests in the end, even though you may generate multiple requests concurrently, you'll still wait for the latency of each of them. So when multiple threads share the DRAM controller, and the DRAM controllers are not aware of a thread's memory level parallelism, the DRAM controller can service each thread's outstanding request serially, not in parallel. And as a result, you may actually lose the benefits of all of these techniques that you implement in the processor to actually generate lots of requests in parallel, only to have the DRAM controller serialize all those requests. So in the end, you're wasting a lot of effort. You're designing these complex processors that are generating requests in parallel, and the DRAM controller, a stupid DRAM controller, basically makes all of your efforts go to waste. Right? So that was the realization in this. Basically, I'll show this to you pictorially. You have the bank level parallelism of a thread. If you have a single thread, let's assume thread A, it computes and it generates two DRAM requests. It happens to be concurrent. Right? You can imagine many programs doing this. The first request goes to bank 0. The second request goes to bank 1. Rows are not that important, actually, in this case. The memory controller receives these requests. It services, starts servicing this request first. And then because banks are, you can pipeline the request to different banks because they share the buses, it starts servicing the second request in this in bank 1 next. And then the request latencies are overlapped, and then the requests return, and the processor can make progress, right? Assume that the processor can make progress only when it receives both of the requests. Okay? So it's nice. In this case, bank access latencies of the two requests are overlapped. As a result, the thread stalls for approximately one bank access latency, right, if you look at this. Now let's take a look at what happens if you have two of these same threads running together. What could happen? They both generate two DRAM requests in their cores. These requests get to the memory controller in this order, let's say, and assume that the memory controller services them in the order it receives them. The memory controller first takes thread A's request to bank 0, schedules it, and then thread B's requests to bank 1 and schedules it. And then these requests complete, and then the memory controller can take thread B's request to bank 0 and schedule it once bank 0 becomes free, and then takes thread A's request to bank 1 and schedule it once the bank 1 becomes free. And then both threads stall while waiting for these requests. And after a point, the requests come back, and both threads can continue. Now what happened in this case was both threads' requests got serialized, right? Because the memory controller really did not preserve the parallelism of each thread. So can we do better? That's the key question. And well, basically what happens is each thread stalls for two bank access latencies instead of one we've seen before. So can we do better? And the, I guess because I'm talking about this, we can do better. And that's the idea of designing a parallelism-aware scheduler. And the idea is actually really simple. Both of these threads generate the same request again. And the idea is to have a scheduler that preserves the bank-level parallelism of each thread. Instead of taking, so this, the controller starts with thread A's request and schedules it to bank 0. And then instead of taking the next request in its queue, in order, it basically takes a look at, before scheduling the next request to bank 1, it takes a look at whether there's a request from thread A to bank 1. And there is one over here, so it schedules that request to bank 1 instead of picking a different thread's request to bank 1. Now what we've done is, both banks are servicing requests from thread A. Those request latencies are being hopefully amortized in parallel. Thread B is not making progress. None of its requests are being serviced, but that may be okay. After thread A is done, both of its requests are done, thread A can now continue computing. Thread B is still stalling, and now thread B's requests are being serviced in parallel in the banks. And eventually, those requests get done, and what essentially has been achieved is a lot of saved cycles. Right? And the timeline is still the same for thread B. Thread B did not lose any performance, but thread A gained performance because you preserved its parallelism. That's the key idea of a parallelism-aware batch scheduler. Basically, try to preserve the regularity of requests, if you will. And average stall time is 1.5 bank access latencies, assuming that these are equally weighted. Right? So how do you actually accomplish this? There are actually two principles going on, and I implicitly told you one of the principles. This is the parallelism awareness. And the idea is schedule a request from a thread to different banks back to back. If you've scheduled a request from this thread to a bank, now in the next bank, you're considering prioritize that thread. Right, that's the idea. This preserves each thread's bank parallelism. Right? But there could be a downside to this, right? This can actually cause starvation, right? Because you keep prioritizing this thread's request, and if this thread actually keeps generating more requests, then you're in trouble, perhaps. So the second principle actually tries to fix this by using an old idea, which is request batching. It's actually used in disk systems. So in the old times, when you actually have multiple programs accessing the disk, you have a similar problem, right? Who should the disk service first? So there are a lot of algorithms that are developed for disk scheduling. None of them are parallelism aware, because parallelism awareness is really a property of memory. In disk, you have other constraints, right? Because your head can move only one way. How do you actually schedule the request such that you're fair with a single movement of the head? Right. That's pretty interesting. We're not going to go over that. But the batching idea was developed over there too to minimize starvation. And the idea over here is you have some number of requests in the memory controller, in the buffers. You group them, the oldest ones, into a batch. And you service the batch before all of the other requests. And you don't do reordering across the batches. And you form a new batch when the current one is done. Now, once you do that, you guarantee starvation freedom, because you've serviced that oldest batch first, and then you move to the next batch, and then you move to the next batch. So let me demonstrate. This eliminates starvation and improves fairness. And this also allows parallelism awareness within the batch. So within the batch, you do this. Let's take a look at an example. Let's assume you have two banks and four threads, and each thread has two requests. I'll give you a more complicated example in a little bit. What the memory controller does is, when all of these are queued, it forms a batch and prioritizes this batch over others. And then it forms a ranking of the threads, and then it first sends requests of thread 0, service them in parallel. And other threads requests come in, other requests may come in, but they're not included in the batch, because you have to bound the amount of reordering if you want to ensure that you don't have starvation. Right? And then the memory controller services requests from thread 1 in parallel, and then thread 2 in parallel, but just from the batch. Thread 2 has requests outside the batch, but they don't get serviced. Otherwise, you would actually cause starvation potentially. And then thread 3 in parallel. And then the memory controller goes down, forms a new batch. And then does parallelism awareness within the batch. And then that's how things work. Okay? That's a pretty simple idea, actually. So it has two components. One is request batching to provide starvation freedom. And the other is within batch scheduling to provide parallelism awareness. I'll go through this relatively quickly. So request batching is actually really, really simple to implement. Basically, you can have a bit associated with each request. And to form a batch, you mark up to some number of oldest requests per bank from each thread. And these marked requests basically constitute the batch. And you can form a new batch when there are no marked requests left in the memory controller. And basically, the prioritization policy is you prioritize the marked requests over unmarked ones. Right? This is kind of the highest priority bit that you use in your priority encoder to decide which request to schedule. So you have no reordering of requests across the batches. As a result, you have no starvation, and you have hopefully high fairness. The more difficult question is actually, how do you actually do this parallelism awareness? Within the batch, how do you prioritize requests? So actually, you can use any DRAM scheduling policy. So batching actually, by itself, if you just use batching, that improves both the performance and fairness of the memory scheduling compared to first ready, first come, first serve. But you can actually use first ready, first come, first serve within the batch to exploit row buffer lookouts. But remember, we also want to preserve intra-thread bank parallelism, right, such that we can get higher performance. And the idea here was to service each thread's request back-to-back. So how do you actually do both of these together? And the idea is to form a ranking of the threads. So the scheduler can compute a ranking of threads when the batch is formed. And higher-ranked threads are prioritized over lower-ranked ones. So think of this as a rank order. The hope is that this improves the likelihood that requests from a thread are serviced in parallel by different banks. Because if you form a ranking, all of the bank schedulers obey that ranking. So hopefully you'll select the same thread at the same time. As a result, different threads are prioritized in the same order across all of the banks. So a key question is, how do you actually form this ranking? I'll give you one example of this. But this actually affects system throughput and fairness. Your goal in almost all cases, whenever you have interferences, you want to maximize system throughput while minimizing unfairness. And in this case, remember, the unfairness was equalizing the slowdown of all threads. So if you want to maximize system throughput, as I discussed earlier, you want to minimize the average stall time of threads within the batch, right? Because average stall time correlates with system throughput. If you want to minimize unfairness, the observation is that you want to actually service threads with inherently low stall time early in the batch. So if a thread is not very memory intensive, if it has one request versus another thread has lots of requests, you actually want to prioritize a thread that has only one request, because inherently it has low stall time. If it gets delayed behind these all of these requests, its stall time slowdown will increase significantly. Whereas this thread that has lots of requests, if it gets delayed by a little bit more from this other thread that's not very memory intensive, its slowdown will increase much less. Make sense? So basically the insight is that delaying memory non-intensive threads actually results in high slowdown for those threads. This is actually bad. It turns out this is actually bad for system throughput also. So you really have the same goal in both of these, in this case, because you have batching in the system. So shortest stall time first ranking actually gives you the best performance in this case. You can think of it as shortest job first. I don't know, have you covered scheduling policies in any other course? Yes? Which one? OS, yes. So if you take an OS, you may have seen some of these scheduling policies. So OS, for example, when the OSs are designed, assuming everything is equal priority, you really would like to schedule the job that'll take the shortest amount of time. That really maximizes your throughput, right, in the system. Then the key question is, how do you figure out what will take the shortest amount of time, right? Because when you start a job, you have no idea how long it'll take. And a lot of the OS scheduling policies, people have tried to figure out experimentally, how can we predict which job is going to take long versus short? I'll give you one idea related to this. Basically, people have found that if a job has executed for a long time, it's very likely that it's going to execute long into the future. So what a lot of the OSs try to do is, if a job is executed a long amount of time, they deprioritize those jobs because they're not short jobs, they're really long jobs. Whereas if a job has executed very little, you actually don't know if it'll execute long or short, so you prioritize that to maximize system throughput. And it's more than likely that it's going to execute short. This is called the least attained service scheduling. Basically, if a job has attained a lot of service, if it has been scheduled for a long time, you deprioritize it, and you prioritize the jobs that have attained the least service in the system. It's actually pretty interesting. There's a lot of theory behind it, too. But okay, in this case, we're going to do the shortest job first ranking. Actually, there's a lot of theory even before the OS scheduling. This is actually it's a pretty interesting paper that talks about factory scheduling, actually. How do you actually optimize single stage production? If you have components that are being produced at different rates, different times, how do you actually schedule the production of those components to maximize the throughput of production? Okay, anyway, so you can actually prove if you have a single server, shortest job first is actually the best scheduling policy to maximize throughput. But basically, in this case, we would like to estimate the stall time of each thread within the batch and rank the threads with shorter stall time higher, right, if you want to do a shortest job first ranking. So how do we actually do that? How do we actually estimate this? This actually turns out to be by itself difficult because you have interference between different threads, right? What is the shortest stall time? So what we're going to do is look at two values, maximum number of MARC requests to any bank from each thread. This is called the max bank load. And we'd like to rank the threads with lower max bank load higher because this correlates with longer stall time. If you have lots of requests queued up in a bank, you're going to be delayed. So that's your stall time. And then we're going to also have another value, total number of MARC requests. This is the total load of a thread. This is going to be used to break ties. We're going to rank the thread with lower total load higher. Let me give you an example. It's best understood with an example. Let's say you have these four threads which have different number of requests to different banks. And we have four banks in this case. And assume, I'm not even taking into account the row buffer here. You can actually take a look at the paper to how to include the row buffer. But even with the row buffer, this works. So let's take a look at the max bank load and total load estimations for different threads or calculations. For thread zero, the maximum number of requests attached to any bank is one. And assuming all of its requests are being serviced together, its maximum stall time, or stall time should be one, right? One bank access latency. Ignore the bus delays. So its max bank load is one, its total load is three. It has three total requests. For thread one, its max bank load is two. The maximum number of requests to any bank is two. And assuming all of these requests are serviced in parallel, it's the only thread in the system, its max service latency would be two bank access latencies. And its total load is 4. For thread 2, Its max bank load is again 2. It has 2 requests to bank 1 and 2 requests to bank 2. Its total load is total 6 requests. And thread 3 has the highest stall time, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 max bank loads going to bank 3, and a total load of 9. So now you can actually rank order these threads. Basically, maximum number of requests to any bank, thread 0 has the minimum number, so it's ranked higher, because that's the shortest job, if you will, from the perspective of the memory controller, whereas thread 3 is the longest job, because its max bank load is 5, its stall time is the longest. And thread 1 and thread 2 actually have the same max bank load, but because we use the total load as a tiebreaker. Okay. So now how do you actually improve performance by doing what we've discussed, by actually ranking threads in this batch? So look at if you look at this order, this is the baseline scheduling order. Assume that it's the arrival order. If you ignore the row buffer, this makes sense. And these are the requests that are serviced at different times. Assume we're looking at an abstract notion of time in terms of bank access latencies. And I'm ignoring a lot of things like bus delays over here, right? But that's okay, in the end it'll work out. Because this is just to demonstrate the idea. So if you calculate the stall times for thread 0, the last request is serviced after 4 bank access latency, so its stall time is 4. For thread 1, the last request is serviced after 4 bank access latencies again, so its stall time is 4. Because remember, we're using the same arrival order as a scheduling order. For thread 2, the last request is serviced after 5 bank access latencies, so its stall time is 5 within this batch. And thread 3, the last request is serviced after 7 bank access latencies, so its stall time is 7. So if you look at this, the average stall time is 5 across all of these threads, 5 bank access latencies. Now let's take a look at what happens with parallelism over batch scheduling. If you use the rank order we've computed in the previous slide. Basically, we rank thread 0 over thread 1 over thread 2 over thread 3. So the scheduler has all of these requests. It will basically first schedule thread 0's requests. And all of them are serviced in parallel in the banks. As a result, your stall time is 1 bank access latency for thread 0. For thread 2, thread 1, this is the scheduling that will happen. Right? Remember, this is a prioritization order. Thread 0 is prioritized over thread 1 because there is no request that goes to bank 0 from thread 0. As a result, thread 1's requests get serviced. And it's kind of like playing Tetris, right? You're putting the different bricks together such that you can actually maximize the bandwidth that's coming out of the banks. That's why it kind of looks like a Tetris over here. So thread 1 has 2 bank access latencies as its stall time because its last request is serviced after 2 bank access latencies. And its parallelism is preserved if you look at this, right? It's not prioritized over T0, but its parallelism is preserved. Thread 2, now its Tetris fits this way. It's prioritized this way. And as a result, its max bank access latency, well, its stall time is 4. Its last request is serviced after 4 bank access latencies, either in bank 1 or bank 2. And the last thread that goes is thread 3, that's prioritized the least, and its bank access latency is 7. So again, you don't, its stall time is 7. And you don't actually lose performance on this one, right, if you look at this, because we construct this example nicely to show the benefit. So the average over here is 3.5 bank access latencies. So you can actually significantly improve system throughput this way. So if you do the calculation, it's about 30% for this particular batch. But remember, there are other requests that are outside the batch that I didn't deal with over here. So your maximum system performance improvement isn't this high, in fact. Okay? So does this make sense to you guys? Basically, this shows you the benefits of actually keeping the bank level parallelism in a real scheduler. And it turns out this is actually relatively easy to implement compared to what I described to you earlier. Well, the reason is, let's look at the scheduling policy, right? Basically, your scheduling policy is marked requests are serviced over everything else. The second priority order, it could be row hit requests are serviced over other things. And all else being equal, higher rank threads are serviced over others, and oldest first is this way. So this is the batching part, and this is the parallelism over within batch scheduling part. Okay? And then you may actually wonder why did we do this, right? Actually, it turns out there's a trade-off between row buffer locality and bank parallelism. You want to preserve row buffer locality. You also want to preserve bank level parallelism. And they go against each other. And there's no best way, actually, picking. So it turns out, even if you reorder these, if you put 3 as a higher priority and put 2 as a lower priority, you get similar performance. Okay, anyway, I'm going to skip the slide, but basically, the hardware cost of this is relatively low. It's basic on an 8-core system. You have very little storage cost. You don't have any complex operations, no divisions over here. And it's not on the critical path also. Scheduler makes a decision only every DRAM cycle. So you can actually do this relatively easily. So what is the benefit you get? Let me just give you an overview of this, and then we'll move on to the next scheduler, and then we'll end after that, hopefully. But basically, these are average results across many workloads. And you can look at the paper. This is the unfairness. And unfairness is lower is better, right? You would like to make unfairness closer to 1 because it's the maximum memory slowdown of any thread divided by minimum memory slowdown of any thread. For row hit first scheduling, it's pretty high. It's about 5 if you have 16 cores, right? For if you actually do eliminate the row hit consideration, if you do first come, first serve, unfairness is still pretty high. And this is another scheduler that works similarly to network routers, right? Routers actually do a lot of quality of service. And they employ some policies. If you actually adapt those policies to memory controllers, you still have unfairness because they don't take into account this parallelism, for example, right? And they actually try to provide bandwidth fairness. They try to equalize bandwidth across different streams. This is stall time fair memory scheduling. So stall time fair memory scheduling actually improves fairness significantly. And this parallelism over batch scheduling, it improves fairness even more. So you get closer to 1. It's not perfectly 1, but getting perfectly 1 is very difficult, right? Okay, and this is system performance. So you get significant system performance improvements also by preserving parallelism as well as by doing stall time fair memory scheduling. Okay, so there are actually interesting things happening over here, which we will not go into, but if you look at this, row hit first policy is performing worse than first come first serve over here, and first come first serve is actually better than, worse than here. But here, row hit first is performing better than first come first serve. So it really depends on which threads you prioritize. So it's very hard to predict how much performance you would get. So let me tell you about the upsides and downsides of this. So basically, this is the first schedule that addresses bank level parallelism destruction across multiple threads. And it just makes sense to do this, right? In fact, increasingly going forward, this will become more important, especially if you employ processors that do use out of order execution. You're already paying a lot of cost to out of order execution to generate these requests in parallel. If your DRAM controller is stupid to serialize requests, then you have a problem, right? You're really not balancing your system. And remember from the first lecture, balanced design is the goal of an architect in the end. If you're putting a lot of effort into your system just so that some other part of your system is going to ignore all of that and actually turn the benefits, lose the benefits that you would potentially get, then you have a problem in your system. It's a simple mechanism compared to STFM. And batching provides fairness. Batching is actually the easiest part to build, and it's actually implemented in some memory controllers today. And ranking actually enables parallelism awareness. There are downsides to this, and I think one big downside is it doesn't always prioritize the latency-sensitive applications. So if you look at this, you form a batch, right? Actually, a batch is really rigid. What if you form a batch, and then an application generates a request right after that? And that's the only request generated by that application. Well, too bad. This application was unlucky. Right? It needs to wait this entire batch to finish before its request can get serviced. So that's the problem with this scheduler. So that's what we're going to try to solve with a more heterogeneous scheduling policy. Any questions? Is this interesting? Okay, cool. Maybe you can apply it. Actually, some of these ideas are applicable to other parts of the system also. So, let's take a look at these schedulers a little bit. Ideally, our goal is to get higher system throughput and better fairness, right? And I'm not going to talk about this metric over here, but you can read from the papers. In fact, if you read one of the papers, you would see in this. So ideally, you would like to be around here. Right? And let's take a look at what different workloads do. Atlas is a memory scheduler, which I didn't talk about, but its goal is to purely maximize system throughput. So it actually borrows from the operating system principle that I just talked in a little bit. It prioritizes threads that have attained the least service from memory so far. It basically keeps a counter for each thread. It's very simple. And it looks at how much service it has received in the last interval from memory. And it ranks the threads based on the service they received. The thread that has received the least service is ranked highest. The thread that has received a lot of service is ranked the lowest. And in the next interval, the threads are prioritize according to that order. basically the threads that have received least service get priority. Why does this make sense? Well, again, because of the principle that I described, right? If a thread has received a lot of service, it's very likely that it's very memory intensive. It's going to request even more service. So let's deprioritize it. And other threads that have received least service, well, they're probably short jobs, if you will. They're not going to request a lot. So they're not very memory intensive. As a result, prioritizing them would improve system throughput because these threads are the threads that keep their cores busy. So Atlas is a good scheduler for that, actually. It has a system throughput bias, unfortunately, if you look at this. Well, it's not clear here because we don't have other schedulers, but if you put ParBS, it has a fairness bias, it turns out, because of the batching. It's really hard in this batching, right, as we've discussed. STFM is not good for anything. It's farther from this Pareto optimal curve over here. And this is first ready, first come, first serve. It's actually much farther. And if you actually look at first come, first serve, for these workloads, it happens to sit here. Performance is terrible, but fairness is not that bad. So how do we actually get to this ideal? So if you think about it, you actually have two different goals over here. One is throughput, and the other is fairness. If you take the throughput-biased approach, we would really like to do is this, prioritize less memory-intensive threads. That's what kind of Atlas does. You rank the threads that have are less memory-intensive over others, so you form a ranking. And if you give higher priority to the thread that is least memory-intensive, that thread, its request gets serviced and keeps its core busy because it's not going to generate requests for a while. Right? Whereas this thread, thread C, is the elephant, if you will, it keeps generating lots of requests all the time. Whereas this thread A is a mouse. It basically gets serviced and then does its own thing. Whereas elephant is always going to keep requesting things. So in a sense, if you prioritize thread C over the elephant over the mice gets killed, right? So this is good for throughput. The problem is now thread C can potentially starve because there may be a lot of threads in front of thread C. As a result, you get unfairness over here. In fact, the unfairness could be even worse for something that's around here. Assume that you have 50 threads over here, right? If you look at the fairness biased approach, one way of doing fairness is taking turns, right? Round robin scheduling. Basically, if you take turns, you give access to thread C for a while, and then access to thread A, and then access to thread B. This doesn't starve. This is good. This gets its bandwidth. The problem is thread A is not prioritized, right? So you get reduced throughput, because if you actually prioritize thread A, you get much better throughput. So the realization is that a single policy for all threads is actually insufficient. These call for different kind of policies. So how do you achieve the best of both worlds? Well, in general, heterogeneity is the right answer. So we're going to design a heterogeneous scheduling policy. So for throughput, we're going to figure out what are the threads that are not memory intensive and prioritize them over others. And if you do this right, you're not going to hurt fairness because these threads do not require a lot of bandwidth from the memory system. They're very little. They're little mice. For fairness, it turns out a lot of the fairness problems are caused by these heavy elephants being prioritized for a long time before one another. So if you actually prioritize a medium-sized elephant to a large-sized elephant, a medium memory-intensive thread to a large, heavy memory-intensive thread, always this heavy memory-intensive thread doesn't get its bandwidth requirement satisfied. As a result, you're unfair. So if you shuffle the thread rankings once in a while, then you fix this problem, right? You don't always prioritize one over the other, but you keep shuffling. And these actually have different vulnerabilities to interference, so you actually do this shuffling in a more intelligent manner, and I'm not going to talk about this. Basically, you prioritize the threads. You give priority to threads that are more vulnerable to interference more often. They become higher ranked. So how does this work? Basically, you can group the threads into two clusters based on the memory intensity. And you can actually imagine how to do that, right? You look at an interval and you say, oh, this thread has generated this many requests during this interval. So it's not very memory intensive, or it's memory intensive depending on a threshold. And then you form two clusters, and you prioritize the non-intensive cluster over the intensive cluster, and then within each cluster, you employ different policies. Within this throughput-oriented cluster, you prioritize the threads that have achieved that actually are least memory intensive, because your goal is throughput over here, whereas here, your goal is fairness. Yes?
But to segregate them, you need to run them for a while. Then.
That's right, exactly, yes.
So do you just run them in batches, or how do you run them? And then within the batch, you segregate, or how do you do it?
Well, you run the policy. So there's an initial part where you run and you figure out the characteristics, and then after that you're basically warmed up. Okay? So the policy is always running, basically, this policy. Except you're using information from the previous interval to figure out what's...
Initially,
yeah.
You have them in batches, or how do you...
Oh, there are no batches here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so
in this...
run a bunch of them together and then just...
Exactly, yes. Uh-huh. Okay. So how do you actually do this, basically? How do you cluster the threads? This is one way of doing it, basically. Look at the misses per kilo instruction of the threads, and then look at the total memory bandwidth usage, and then declare... These threads that are using a fraction of the memory bandwidth form the non-intensive cluster. And this could be 10%, for example, right? And the rest is the intensive cluster. So let's say you basically have a quantum-based operation. In the previous quantum, you monitor the thread behavior, memory intensity, bank load, parallelism, robo for locality. I didn't talk about these, but these actually affect how vulnerable you are to interference. And the next, in the beginning of the quantum, you perform this clustering. So the hardware is doing this, memory controller. And you compute the nicest of intensive threads. That's to do this asymmetric shuffling. And then you shuffle the ranking in the next interval. So in the next interval, you actually use the information that's being collected in the previous interval. And this is a scheduling algorithm. I'm not going to go through this because I've already told you all of this. Basically, highest rank first. And how do you determine rank is dependent on the clustering. And row hit first next, and then oldest first next. So where does this take us, basically? Let's take a look at these different schedulers again. Basically, if you have a heterogeneous scheduling policy, you can kind of break this Pareto optimal frontier, right? You're actually pushing to get closer to the ideal. Basically, having this heterogeneous scheduling policy provides the best fairness and system throughput at the same time. And whenever you have multiple metrics, actually having heterogeneity is a good idea. Of course, there's a cost to heterogeneity, which is more complexity, right? It's more complex than both Atlas and PowerBS, in fact, because you need to do this clustering. You need to collect more information, okay? And actually, there are more things you can do when you vary the configuration parameter, which is interesting. You get this kind of behavior. And usually, memory scheduling algorithms have configuration parameters. For TCM, it's the cluster threshold, right? How do you trade off between fairness and throughput? For FRFCFS, there is a parameter, right? And the parameter is basically how many requests you reorder beyond the oldest requests. This is called CAP. In fact, some AMD memory schedulers implemented this early on in the multi-core designs. And basically, they cap the number of reorderings that could happen over the oldest request. And if you change that, you get this really weird curve, because it doesn't give you any idea of what fairness or throughput you would get. So you get basically a more robust fairness and throughput threshold with this kind of scheduler. Of course, within the limits of cluster threshold. If your cluster threshold is 100 or 0, then you don't get this kind of behavior. So what are the upsides and downsides? Basically, this kind of scheduler, heterogeneous scheduler, provides you high fairness and high performance at the same time. And hopefully, it caters to the needs of different types of threads. So you can imagine doing this clustering not necessarily dynamically. So I've described this from the point of view of a multi-core system. But you can imagine CPU versus GPU, right? Latency sensitive versus bandwidth sensitive. You can imagine someone giving you this information in that kind of system, right? These are latency-sensitive threads. These are bandwidth-sensitive threads. Latency-sensitive threads should probably go into the non-intensive cluster, right? And it's relatively simple. Not so simple, but compared to STFM, it's simple. So there are a lot of downsides to this also, which I'm not going to talk about. Basically, how do you actually scale this kind of scheduler to large buffer sizes? It turns out that scalability becomes an issue, actually, because you're really taking into account a lot of things, a lot of information. So having a single monolithic scheduler becomes difficult to design. And Rachada can tell you about more scalable memory schedulers because he's worked on them. And how do you actually do this clustering robustly? How do you do this shuffling robustly? Because whenever you divide things into two clusters, that threshold matters, right? What if you actually not chosen the right threshold and a thread actually gets denied service because it fell into the intensive cluster, right? So there's always a robustness issue whenever you chop things into two clusters. And how do you solve the robustness issue? Well, maybe you randomize things. You add some more probabilistic behavior into the system. Say, oh, sometimes I do the clustering with this threshold, sometimes I do this clustering with that threshold. But I'm not going to talk about these. Okay, any questions? Yes?
Why would the throughput from TCM be higher than Atlas?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, exactly because of the so throughput and fairness are actually coupled, right? The The reason is actually hidden in the shuffling. Where is the shuffling? Yeah. So when you do, when, if you don't do the shuffling, if you actually always rank one thread over the other, some threads do not utilize their cores well. If you do the shuffling, you kind of enable proportional progress in the cores. So you get better system utilization. Make sense? So ranking all of the threads in a strict order is not a good idea for throughput either. So for throughput, what you really want to do is identify those threads that would contribute to the throughput and prioritize them over others and do more proportional progress for the other threads. I mean, ideally, you would like to find a way of estimating the utility of prioritizing one thread over the other, right? And say, oh, this is, if I service this thread, it'll contribute to system performance this much versus this thread, versus this thread, versus this thread, and then pick the thread that would contribute the most to the system performance. But that turns out to be very, very difficult to do. That requires a really good performance model. Okay? All right, I guess let's stop here. In the next lecture, we'll start with other ways of handling interference and then move on to some other memory-related topics.